He ran the Mont Aldo campus almost like an army barracks. A very, very demanding person, but friendly. He usually had a pair of the World War II combat boots with the two buckles on top. You had to wear a tie to get into the dining hall for the evening meal. And even though you'd spent the afternoon out in the forest, and you came in with a Woolrich wool plaid shirt on, you clipped a bow tie onto the shirt, and that allowed you to get into the mess hall. I will never forget his comment to us that first day. Look at the man on your right, and now look at the man on your left. One of you won't be here at the end of the year. And he was right.
Goddard took a hands-on approach, taking forestry students out of the class and into the woods.
You spent Saturday and Sunday practicing and going out and reinforcing what you had learned the week before. You stayed right there and worked. And we would go out and work on the state forest land, cutting undesirable trees.
Doc knew every one of the native trees, all 127 species of native trees in Pennsylvania, and he knew them all intimately. He could describe the character of the wood fiber. He could describe the bark, the buds, and the pattern of growth, whether they're determined or indeterminate growth. And he was a walking encyclopedia of forests.
When I was at Mont Aldo, I wanted to emulate. he was my mentor.
In 1952, Penn State University President Milton Eisenhower appointed Goddard as the head of the forestry department at Penn State's main campus. And by 54, the school had the second largest enrollment of forestry students in the country. Goddard made sure the students were actively contributing to community projects and the Pennsylvania Forest Plan set out by the State Department of Forests and Waters, an agency that would soon embrace a professional overhaul brought on by the newly elected governor of 1955.
I was looking for somebody to lead.
George M. Leader was the 36th governor elected in Pennsylvania, taking office on January 18, 1955. He was only the 8th Democratic candidate to fill the position since the turn of the 19th century, winning the polls against his opponent, Republican Lieutenant Governor Lloyd Wood. High on the to-do list, revamping his cabinet positions from party shoo-ins to qualified professionals.
In the old days, before that, if you contributed $25,000 to the Republican Party in the campaign, you were automatically almost offered a cabinet post. And many of those business and legal profession people did take a post, and they were what we call T2T people. They came in Tuesday morning, and they went home Thursday afternoon. So if you wonder why Pennsylvania government was probably 25 to 50 years out of date, it's because those bureau heads were protecting their flanks and making mighty sure that they'd survive in that job long enough to get their pension. 52 people report to the governor. Most all of those were in the cabinet. And I was determined to get professionals.
One of the positions Leader was looking to overhaul was the secretary of the Department of Forests and Waters, a job under Leader that would require extensive knowledge and technical expertise with regards to Pennsylvania's natural resources. Goddard was the perfect fit.
At that time, I didn't know Goddard. So he had never been on the political scene.
There were no indications, really, that Goddard had any ambitions other than doing what he was doing, you know, teaching. Governor Leader, he had gotten Goddard's name from Genevieve Blatt, you know, another famous Pennsylvania advocate.
So I said to Genevieve, I said, Genevieve, I really would like to have someone who could take that Department of Forests and Waters and really rev it up, make something meaningful out of it. She said, well, my brother Joe went to Penn State, and he majored in forestry. And she said he always spoke so highly of Maurice Goddard. I said, oh, that's interesting.
So out of the blue, Leader calls him, and the thing I find so amazing about the story is apparently Doc didn't miss a beat and said, sure, I'll come in.
Which for a conservative lifestyle man like Maurice Goddard, was a very quick decision. I would have said, well, I got to go home and talk it over with my wife, and I got to talk to the president of Penn State, and I got to see if they can find somebody to take my place for a while. But he didn't. He said, yes, I'd be interested.
Came into Harrisburg. They apparently had a great lunch. Leader talks about, you know, from the get-go. He didn't doubt for 1 minute his ability to get the job done that he was looking to do, because environmental initiatives were right at the top of the plate. So the question of whether or not an academic could do it, that was important. And Goddard put those concerns to bed, apparently just over, you know, lunch. He goes back up to Penn State, and before he even gets there, you know, he gets a call and says, hey, I want to offer you the job.
He's got the job. Well, he was delighted, and I was delighted, and it was a great day. It was a great day for Pennsylvania.
The Department of Forests and Waters was off to a running start, armed with a new secretary determined to make a difference. Goddard started strong, immediately vetoing a $4.5 million timber cutting contract set forth by the preceding secretary, Sam Lewis, for Perry County. Environmental concerns were top priority for both Goddard and Leader, in particular the Black Hills of Pennsylvania's mountain ranges, decimated by years of strip mining.
Strip mining was going wild. And when we flew from Harrisburg to Scranton, just one after another and another and another of those mountaintops, I wanted to overcome the setback we had from all that strip mining.
Restoration plans were in the making, and within a few years, Goddard's team would successfully reseed entire tracts of land.
Even by the time I left, a good many, if not all of those strip mined areas had been regraded and replanted. He did a wonderful job.
Goddard had proven himself, but the effectiveness of the department went beyond the abilities of one man. It would take a concerted push for professionalism to truly develop the kind of cream-of-the-crop department Goddard and Leader envisioned. Difficult decisions were made when it came to hiring and firing, and one of the tactics used to bolster their team required employees to take the civil service exam.
Goddard's message is crystal clear that running a program as complex as he did in Pennsylvania requires people who, by training and experience, knew what the hell they were doing.
When you talk to the people that worked for DOC, they will come back to this issue of civil service and professionalism and technical expertise and scientific-based management. And those all happen with Leader and DOC. A unique caveat to that is the fact that they couldn't get it through the legislature and had to stick it through in an executive order.
We had about 80 votes in the House, needed 106. I don't know what we'd have gotten in the Senate, but less than half, I'm sure. So we had it under the old Constitution of 1874. We could put those jobs under civil service by executive board action. And if my memory serves me right, Maurice was on the executive board.
The executive order would eventually pass under the Governor Scranton administration, but in the meantime, Leader and Goddard surrounded themselves with the kind of people who could rise to the environmental challenges of Pennsylvania.